Welcome to this video on Colfax RPA. My name is Jesper Scherpenhuizen and today I want to talk about process discovery. This is one of those videos that I've been wanting to make for a very long time and I'm going to tell you exactly why a bit later on. But before we do that, let's address the elephant in the room, the picture that you're seeing on your screen right now and which I'll be referring to a couple of times throughout this video. This is actually the first picture ever taken of a black hole. Before we had this perfect piece of empirical evidence, we only had simulations, we had theory, we had circumstantial evidence, and we now finally have confirmation of that. And this is, of course, very interesting for me because I used to study physics and astrophysics, and my alma mater, the Radboud Universiteit Nijmegen, was part of the international team that undertook this endeavor, and they truly delivered on top of that. And, well, you might now say, well, what does that have to do with process discovery? Well, the thing is, it's a very nice allegory for what we're working on. So as I said, all of the information we had before this picture of that black hole and were things like the simulation they're looking at right now. This was, of course, all based on circumstantial evidence, the things that we saw happening, how the black holes were interacting with the universe surrounding it. So we didn't have a right way to actually analyze the black hole. We were only able to see how it was influencing the things surrounding it. And that's essentially the exact same thing that we're doing right now, because what we're interested in is we want to distill processes from user interactions. So there is typically no process. There is no description of what we're interested in yet. It could be that this is information or a way of working that's been handed down from employee to employee. Let's call that a bit of tribal knowledge, if you want, where you see people just, well, making sure that they mentor each other and this is how it should be done. But that doesn't necessarily mean that these kind of processes aren't either ripe for process optimization or maybe even process automation. Well, and that's where we come in. So again, process discovery is software that's capable of capturing user interactions on websites, applications, you name it. All of the surfaces that RPA typically works on, process discovery is able to see how people actually interact with them. And we then use that information and analyze that and use our patented artificial intelligence on to make sure that we're able to give recommendations on process optimization, but also to say, well, this is a great candidate for process automation, like, for instance, RPA. So this is, of course, something that we've been working on for quite some time. So the first version of process discovery was already released in RPA 10.4, which is approximately 2 years old, if I'm not mistaken. And we've made tremendous improvements in 10.7. And then over the course of 11.0 and 11.1, we're seeing a bit more features and capabilities being added to it. And then, of course, in the future version, for instance, 11.2, you're going to see great improvements in the visualization of the outcomes here. So it's able to take all that information, analyze it, and then visualize it to people like, for instance, a COE lead or a middle manager, or maybe someone that's just mainly interested to see, hey, what's the next big thing going to be for us in RPA? So we do get a lot of recognition for this, and process discovery in general is something that's been very well recognized. I've put this quote from Gartner on the screen, and it is exceptionally great to see that confirmation where they say, well, these go hand in hand, RPA and process discovery. So that's something that I really like to see from not just Gartner, but also the other analysts. So before we actually start into the actual demo, I do want to make sure that everyone's on the same page in regards to what Colfax RPA process discovery is, and maybe just as important, also what it is not. So, as said, this is software that captures user interactions. It's able to analyze, of course, those screens and websites, whatever they're working on, and it then uses that information, it stores it centrally, and it's able to analyze and distill, based on artificial intelligence, machine learning, you name it, these, well, hidden processes and visualize them and make sure that we have recommendations on what we can do. And because it's an integral part of Kofax RPA, it just works out of the box. And it is included with RPA, as said, since 10.4. It is, of course, fully supported by Kofax. So you don't need to worry about, well, does this work with X, Y, and Z? No, if you've got Kofax RPA, process discovery will just work. And then, as said, what it is not something that you can just buy. So you can't call your Kofax rep and say, I'd like one process discovery, please, because it's part of Kofax RPA. So if you've got that, you're good. What you'll need is you'll need to have that RPA license and you'll need to have that Insight license. And we've been including the Insight license with RPA for quite some time now. So if you don't have an Insight license, then I would recommend to give your Kofax rep a call. Why do we need that Insight license? Because we are leveraging the Kofax Insights dashboards to visualize these outcomes. So if you have Kofax Analytics for RPA installs, you might already see the tab Process Discovery there. And maybe very important to point out is that Process Discovery is not a traditional process mining tool in the classical meaning of the term, because Kofax RPA Process Discovery does not look at these transactional logs that classical process mining solutions do. It only considers what it can see and take from those user interactions. So it's able to see the applications you're interacting with, the data that you're working with, and it's able to distill the underlying process from there. So without further ado, let's jump in. So this is my desktop, and before we actually start the demo and tell you all about what we're going to do and what you're going to see, let's frame this correctly and really set the stage. So I'm going to be taking on the role for now of the line of business employee. So my job is to do OFAC checks for new customers, but maybe also existing customers that we might have, and we need to take those into account for know your customer due diligence, anti-money laundering, you name it. Our organization has rolled out Process Discovery, but I am still in control because the agent is there and it's visible. So I can at any time just say, stop that recording. So what we need in order to connect this agent that's going to do all that capturing of user interactions, I need to point that to the management console. I need to tell it which group I'm in or to which group I want to log. And we need to provide it with credentials for the actual management console to connect to. So if we then click start recording, you're going to see that we need to make sure that the agent actually is running, that the management console is connected, and that we're able to write all of these events, all of these interactions to the database. Okay, so this agent also has one other very interesting tool, and that is start task. So I could actually just keep this system running and it's going to record everything I'm doing. But if I know, well, this is something that the COE or a citizen developer, a building professional, whatever, is very interested in, I could just start a task and it's then gonna flag all of the events that I'm gonna be working on and all the interactions up until that point where I click stop task. It's gonna flag them as a separate process. So you would then have them immediately ready to be picked up. So we could actually also turn that around, right? Where I might be a bot builder, a citizen developer, whatever I am, and I need to be building a specific bot, but I don't have enough information on how to do that. I can then go to a line of business worker and ask them, well, could you please do task X, Y, and Z. But if you do that, could you please press start task before you started and click stop task afterwards? Because then I'm going to get a full report of all the interactions you've done, and it's going to make my life so much easier, because I then have that report with all screenshots, with all of the interactions already documented. And this is, of course, going to save so much time, because you don't have to do those screenshots yourself. It's just going to be there. There might be people who are a bit concerned about privacy here. As said, the employee is, of course, in charge of whether to start and stop the recording. But also those screenshots that we talked about, those can be automatically blurred. So you would still have the valuable information on where you should click, but you wouldn't be exposing sensitive information like customer data or something. Same thing is, of course, also true for the actual keystrokes that you make. So those are not being logged. We just log keystrokes, not what the actual keystrokes are. So that being said, let's shift back into the line of business worker role, and I need to open up a browser. I need to go to the OFAC website. I need to log in, and of course I still need to learn how to type. You guys know that of me. And we then are connected to the OFAC website, the Office of Foreign Assets Control. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a lookup for one of our new customers, a certain Mr. Simon Schneider. And if I then search for him, you do see that he is known on the OFAC list, which typically does not bode well. But we can take this information and we're going to add that to his onboarding report, his KYC report, his case file, and we're going to let someone else do that. It could be that I need to copy it. It might be that I need to take a screenshot, you name it, depending on the actual process. So that's, of course, step one. And this is just one instance of that process that we are mainly interested in. I could do several other things, but this is the one that we're going to be focusing on today. So what I now need to do is, because I'm not tagging these tasks by hand, but I'm just going to let the system do its job and applying those neural networks to my interactions in order to identify this process. So I need to do this a couple of dozen times, but I'm going to speed the video up and then we'll be back when that work has been done. Just hold tight. Cheers. I hope you enjoyed that. It was real fun to do that recording, but I couldn't have done that without help from my friends Barry and Torbjorn, who are in the same team as me, the Benelux Nordic Sales Engineering team. So guys, thanks again for your help. But now we have that rough data. So what the next step would be is to analyze all these events. And that's where the COFAX RPA Process Discovery Analyzer comes in. That analyzer is, that's the real workhorse here. That is the piece of technology, our patented technology, that clusters all these processes together, that tries its best to detect the edges of where a process starts and finishes. It's there to figure out how similar these all are. And what we've now done is we've taken all of this data that we've gathered over the course of 3 days, and we've analyzed it, and we now will present that to you as well, and try to give some guidance and some insight on that. But before we do that, we need to switch roles, of course. So I will no longer take on the role of the line of business worker, and I will transition to a business analyst, or maybe the COE lead, or in general, someone who's interested in analyzing these sort of processes. So what I'll do is I'll switch to my server, and that server is actually the one running the management console, and also the analytics part for process discovery. So as mentioned, the process discovery dashboards are included with Colfax Analytics for Colfax RPA. So if you install that, you'll have the tab for process discovery there. This first overview screen will provide you with a lot of statistics. As you can see, a lot of these overview information points, we have over 12,000 events recorded over the course of those 3 days. And here you see how that's been shifted. So we have 9,000 on, what was that, on Friday, 5 on Saturday, and 3,000 on Sunday. These are the most common applications that were used, of course, due to the demo part of this, mainly Chrome that was used. But as you can see, we also did some other things on that machine because we wanted to make it as real as can be. So you saw that we kept it running when we did some debugging in the MySQL workbench. We had Notepad open, we did some PowerShell. So PowerShell is indeed used to run the analyzer. And we do all of these other things on this machine. Then the second tab is the processes. We're gonna leave that one for last because less best. And then we have the status screen there too. So here we see all of the events that we had regarding the actual analysis. So when did the analysis start? When did the analysis stop? Any sort of feedback that we want to consider. And you can also see the actual people that were involved in recording all these events. So as we were using demo machines, all of these are pretty nondescript, but in a real world scenario, you would actually see the login credentials for people. Okay, well, let's dive into processes. And the first thing you'll see, and that the other thing was true for the other two pages, is that you can have several groups that you want to present information for. So here we have the ISA group, and we have the customer onboarding group. And if you remember, we did all of our login on the customer onboarding group. Those groups are maintained within the management console. So as you can see, we can create new groups, give them either a shared database or their own database. We can change some of the analysis parameters. So we can actually tweak our AI model that does the clustering, the grouping, edge detection, you name it. And the reason for that is you might want to optimize that by turning some dials here and there, which is of course true for almost all AI platforms that we work with. And then you have the actual groups that we already had. So let's have a look. So we're looking at some additional statistics on the processes. We have found three processes and we're going to dive into all three of them and see how much time was spent. And then we have the actual processes themselves. So as you can see, for all three processes, Chrome was the most used application. The biggest process was the one that we ran 107 times. We spent in total an hour on the process, so without all of the other things around it, surrounding it. And the funny thing is, this was discovered with assistance. So one of those 107 runs was one where we said, okay, start task, record it, and stop the task. So it used that information to group some others there with it as well. It could have done it without, but in this case, it used that information there too. And what you'll see is that all of these processes, so either the one with assistance, let's have a quick look. It starts in Chrome. We fill out the information, we log in, select the right people, and then we said, here we go, we found information, we're gonna copy that and push it back. So here we can actually export this directly to as PDF. So this is actually that suggestion where you might say, well, hey, how about we just submit this to a robot builder? She can then use that to build it. I can actually just quickly open that and you'll see that we have all of that with the screenshots, all of the actions that we do. And this is then your, well, let's call it a functional description, ready to go. So that's the one that was done without assistance. And you have one with assistance and you have some variety here and there as well. So if I look at this here, you'll see that we actually not start with Chrome already open, but we actually had to open up Chrome and then we dive into it. So that's the kind of variety you can find there. But still, it's recognizing that as being part of the same process. The system is that intelligence, and you can do that for all of these instances. You can also create an overview PDF for that as well. And what we then found is that one of us three did it slightly different. And here you can see that even though it was the same process, but someone really had their own way of doing that. And here you can see how that was done. Beautiful to see that even though us three had the same instructions, we did it differently. We can then have this information, and we can then use that either to change the process, so better briefing for these employees, or we can use this for robot development. And then the funny thing was, and this was quite a surprise for us, is that over the course of those 3 days, we also found another process. And funny enough, we kept the recorder running, and we totally forgot about that. And we ran some of our other demos. So in this case, we can immediately see that we did the so-called SCM demo, the supply chain management demo, and it found that that was one of the processes that we might be able to automate. So I thought that was funny. So we actually have this now ready. So we now have a beautiful demo here that we can use to show the absolute power of process discovery within Colfax RPA. So let's do a very quick recap and also give you some leave behinds that you can use in your process discovery endeavors. It's always going to be pretty straightforward. The first thing you need to do is you need to install those agents. And as mentioned, you can do that in a managed approach where you just have IT roll these out to everyone. You can do some configuration on the management console. You need to instruct people to work with it, of course. And then you can actually start capturing data. And then after a while, you'll start to see these patterns emerging if you set up your analyzer to analyze it every night or maybe over the weekend, you name it. And once you then have that, you can then start to have these processes being visualized in your Insight dashboards, and that's going to be driving your robot pipeline for years on end if you don't really look out. But it's also going to be a tremendous insight into what is actually happening in the lines of business, what kind of work people are still doing. And of course, as mentioned, they will be comfortable with that because they are in full control of this. And once you have that visualized and you can start optimizing these processes, you can start automating the repetitive tasks, people will see the benefit of this. And well, you then have everything in hand to really drive your automation initiatives to the next level. And this will actually enable you to, if you start recording today, you'll be able to work like tomorrow in the very near future. I really hope you enjoyed this. This has been long in the making, so to say. Please leave a comment, like this video, share it with anyone else you want. And for those of you who like my content, feel free to subscribe. That's it. Have a great day. Thanks so much for your time. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Bye-bye.